My last day one happened. Nope, I quit. Not putting away.
What?
No.
I guess. That's what we are doing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Not on the first one, yeah. Let me see. The last one, Our God, He's Alive, should be 1, 2, and 4. We're good. I got the slides right here. Thank you. Good morning. It's going to time to start our morning worship. As we work our way to our seats, we'll sing Hilltops of Glory. Oh, hold on. Let me get this mic. Hilltops of Glory. They took this one out of our new songbook. I don't know why. I love this song, so... Onward rejoicing, I tread life's way. Higher I'm climbing each passing day. The hilltops of glory now rise in view, where all shall be made new. Hilltops of glory, oh brother, won't you come go with me? Safe on the mountain I soon shall stand, hilltops of glory land. Way down in Egypt mid burning sand, Moses had stared it for Canaan's land. Never turn backwards, always ascend, onto the journey's end. Hilltops of glory, oh brother, won't you come go with me? Safe on the mountain I soon shall stand, hilltops of glory land. Footsteps of Jesus before us lead. We tread life's journey, his warnings heed. Evil allurements cannot prevail. I'm on the upward trail. Hilltops of glory, oh brother, won't you come go with me? Safe on the mountain I soon shall stand, hilltops of glory land.
Good morning again. Good morning. And you probably will hear it from somebody else too. Thank you for coming this morning. I know it was hard getting out and walking out on your white carpet. But however, you did walk on your white carpet, something that God put out there for us to walk on. Enjoy the snow. To our visitors, we want to welcome you. And please enjoy our worship services and sing along with us. And sign a visitor's card so we can know your presence. There are some visitors that we do know, and when we meet them, when we meet them and see them, they don't seem like visitors. They seem like a part of the family here at Holmes Road. Sit back and sing and enjoy the worship services. We got a treat for you this morning. Just open your ears and listen to the word of God. Let's sing for more.
Oh, I get a song book. Father along. 753. Tempted and tried, we're oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long, while there are others living about us, never molested, though in the wrong. Father alone will know all about it. You know, Father alone will understand why. You gotta cheer up, my brother, start living in the sunshine. We'll understand it, yes, all by and by. Faithful till death, says our loving master. A few more days to labor and wait. Tolls of the road will then seem as nothing as we sleep through the beautiful gate. Father alone will know all about it. You know, Father alone will understand why. You gotta cheer up, my brother, start living in the sunshine. We'll understand it, yes, all by and by. When we see Jesus coming in glory, when he comes from his home in the sky, then we shall meet him in that bright mansion, and we'll understand it, yes, all by and by. Father alone will know all about it. You know, Father alone will understand why. You gotta cheer up, my brother, start living in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne, makes all my wants and wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief, and often escapes the tempter's snare. Thy return, sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, the joy I feel, the bliss I share of those whose ancient spirit burned with strong desire for thy return. With such I hasten to the place where God my Savior showed his face, and gladly take my station there, and wait for thee, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, thy wing shall my petition bear. To him whose truth and faithfulness engage the waiting soul to bless. And since he bids me seek his face, believe his word and trust his grace, I'll cast on him my every care and wait for thee, sweet hour of prayer. Guess we went to the next song quickly. Sorry about that. At this time, Johnson's going to do our prayer and scripture.
The scripture we're reading this morning comes from the book of 1 Timothy, chapter 5, verse 17. 1 Timothy, chapter 5, verse 17. And it reads, "The elders who direct the affairs of the church well are worthy of double honor, especially those whose work is teaching and preaching." Please bow with me. Our gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, we always come to you with bowed heads and humbled hearts, thanking you first for the many blessings that you've given us. Thanking you for allowing us to gather here on another Lord's Day to sing praises to you, to hear messages from your word, and to commune with one another. Father, as we approach this week of Thanksgiving, Lord, I pray that we always have thankful hearts, but especially this week, Lord, I pray that we reflect upon all that we have to be thankful for. Father, we're thankful for each other, we're thankful for our families, we're thankful for all the material blessings we have, but Lord, most of all, we are thankful for your son, Jesus. Lord, we're thankful that you loved us and he loved us so much that he was willing to die on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins, Lord, and I pray that there's not a day or moment that goes by that we take that for granted. Lord, I pray that we reflect on that and we truly understand what that means. I pray that we understand, though, that also comes with the responsibility. Lord, that we have been entrusted with the gospel, the good news, and we have a responsibility, Lord, to share that good news with everyone that we come in contact with. Lord, I pray that we take that responsibility seriously and we do it with zeal, we do it with passion, Lord, and that people can see that we love you in all the ways that you work in our life. Father, I pray for those that are traveling this week. We pray that they have traveling mercies and that they arrive to their destination safely and that they make it back safely. Lord, I pray that the fellowship that we have during this week with our family is pleasant and positive and that we encourage one another. Father, thank you for many ways that you bless us and you touch our lives. Be with the speaker this morning as he presents the message that he's prepared, and be with all the hearers as well. It's in your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. Sorry about that. Looks like somehow the next song got in mixed up with the last two slides. So it's not the PowerPoint operator. It is in there that way. So, all right. So we're going to sing "Our God, He is Alive." There is beyond the azure blue a God consumed from human sight. He tint the sky with heavenly hue and framed the worlds with his great might.
There is a God,
he is alive. In him we live and we survive. From dust our God created man.
There was a long, long time ago, a God whose voice the prophets heard. He is the God that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word.
There is a God.
He is alive. In him we live. And we survive. From dust our God created man. He is our God, the great I am. Our God, whose son upon a tree alive was willing there to live, that he from sin might set man free, and evermore with him could live. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live, and we survive. From dust a God created man. He is a God, the great I am.
All right, let us prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper. We do have a cup, so if you've got to get one of these private cups, we can get it to you after the song. So just we'll ask and we'll get them past that. But let us focus on the cross as we prepare our mind for the Lord's Supper.
What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not a good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Morning. We come to another part of our service, the communion. I think a lot of time we are having the communion, it considers his blood. If we just can like reestablish our mind and just think about all of the torment, all of the abuse, all of the lashes that was put across his back, all that drew blood from our Lord and Savior. And everything that he did, all the blood that was shed, it was for us. His blood covered a multitude of sins. I am so blessed to be able to say that, because I didn't take not one hit. I didn't take not one lash. You didn't. But he did it for all of us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for taking our punishment. We thank you so much for knowing that you had so much pain and suffering coming to you, but you never wavered not one time. How special is that for us to have a Savior like that? Heavenly Father, as we take of the bread that represents his body, we ask that you do so in a manner which will be most pleasing to him. Just we ask in the most blessed and gracious name. Amen. In the same like manner, he took the cup, which again represents his blood. Again, we are so blessed that he took all the pain and covered all of us with his blood. As we take of the cup, we just wanted to just refocus on the pain and suffering that he absorbed on our behalf. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, again, we just thank you for this cup, this fruit of the vine that represents the blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary for the remission of our sins. Heavenly Father, we just ask that all of us that are partaking of this cup do so in a manner which will be most pleasing to him. This you ask in the most blessed and gracious name. Amen. That ends a part of our communion. Now we are come to another part where we are commanded to give. I know all of us this week, that all of us that have jobs, we don't have those jobs if it wasn't for him.
Amen.
Nothing. We have nothing. So as we give, let's give with a commitment. Let us give cheerfully. As he's given us the opportunities to go out to our jobs, to do our job, to get paid for our jobs. None of that's not happening if it's not him. First and most part is that He woke us up to go to our jobs. If he ain't waking us up, then we ain't going nowhere. So let us just give cheerfully. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for all the opportunities that we have, all the opportunities that you allow us to have. Heavenly Father, just as we commit to our heart to give, let us give cheerfully to the cause that he died for us. This prayer is in your most blessed and gracious name. Amen.
As you know, Stan is in Texas. He's on traveling there for the holidays. So we're going to have one of our elders, Marvin Miller, will be doing this sermon right after this song. Let us stand and sing this song. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my hope, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know He'll take me through, though I am weak and poor. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? Angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just up in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. The song of sweetest praise drifts back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
Good morning. For those that are out there in Facebook land, we want to thank you for taking the time to be able to come and be a participant in our worship services. I want you to know that this isn't the way things were planned. several months ago, we knew that Brother Stan was going to be taking a trip home for the Thanksgiving holiday. And at that time, Brother Roger decided that he would deliver the lesson for this occasion. Unfortunately, Brother Roger's wife, older brother's son died. And Roger and his wife were planning on taking a trip to Louisiana for the funeral. Unfortunately, Roger took ill, and therefore they could not take that trip down to Louisiana. So I'm stepping in for Roger Lewis this morning. As I look at the audience this morning, I want to give you a shout out. You have done something that what is required to be faithful. And you are here under the severe weather conditions that we've had. But I want to thank you for your presence this morning. I want you to turn your Bibles to Psalms 143. Psalms 143. And we read, "Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my supplications. In thy faithfulness, answer me, and in thy righteousness. And enter not into judgment with thy servant, for in thy sight shall no man living be justified. For the enemy has persecuted me, or better than that, has persecuted my soul. He has smitten my life down to the ground. He has made me to dwell in darkness as those that have been long dead. Therefore is my spirit overwhelmed within me. My heart within me is desolate. I remember the days of old. I meditated on all thy works. I muse on the work of thy hand. I stretch forth my hands unto thee. My soul thirsteth after thee as a thirsty land, Selah. Hear me speedily, O Lord. My spirit faileth. Hide not thy face from me, lest I be like unto them that goes down into the pit." Let us pray. Eternal God and Father, we are so thankful that you have allowed us to still be in the land of the living. We're so thankful, Father, that you have provided us with the necessary things of life, food, clothing, and shelter, and our reasonable amount of health. As we come before you this day, we pray, Father, that you will take these words, this particular lesson, as a means of encouragement to our hearts, that will encourage us to be so thankful that you are our God, and that we can call upon you regardless of what crisis, what situation may come our way. Again, forgive us of our sins. These we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. As I was saying in regard to Roger and Robin, we would like to express our condolence for the family at this time. I'm always thankful to be able to present a lesson of God's word. I pray that I will be able to present it in a manner that would be simple and that you can understand it. As I look at my brother Reuben, it is good to see you, brother. You know, we have prayed for brother Reuben, and I'm here to tell you, he came through.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He came through. Because that's the God we have. That's what he'll do. COVID has been challenging for this congregation. I'm here to tell you that we have, by the grace of God, no member of this congregation has died as a result of COVID.
Praise God.
We've been good. He's been good to us. And we have prayed to God Almighty for deliverance in cases, in times like that. We've had members of this congregation that have endured health challenges. They have undergone surgery, and we have prayed to God that he would allow the doctors and the nurses and the staff to be able to minister to them. Guess what? He did. Because that's the God that we serve. That's what he do, or that's what he does. Got a text this morning from Brother Roger indicating that Sister Carol Pace is asking for prayer for someone, and we are going to pray for him. Let me tell you, the God that we serve is willing to come to our rescue, because that's what he do. Let's get into our lesson. This particular psalm is one of the penitential psalms. It is a prayer to be delivered from the psalmist's enemies. It takes the form of a king, prayer for victory and peace. According to Augustine of Hippo, this psalm was likely written during the period of the rebellion of David's son Absalom. But whatever the exact situation, the language is general enough that we all can identify with David. He was in a severe trial where he desperately needed God to answer. Whether your trial this morning is life-threatening, whether you have a life-threatening disease, the need to reconciliate or reconcile between loved ones, cannot get along with a member of the congregation, or maybe you are dealing with a powerful sin that keeps defeating you, or whatever, you're feeling hopeless or in despair. I know that our brother Jonathan can help or provide solutions to us if we are going through those times or those moments where we feel hopeless or in despair. But this morning, I want to title this lesson, "That's What I Do." In Romans chapter 15, verse 4, the Apostle Paul writes, "For whatever soever things were written in time past were written for our learning, that we through the patience and comfort of the scriptures may have hope." You do agree that this chapter was written several thousand years ago, and God was able to bring about deliverance in the life of King David. The scripture says in Acts chapter 10, verse 34, "Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of person." So if God is able to come to the rescue of David, he would do it for you because that is what he does. That is who he is. When you have made that profession of faith to accept him as Lord and Savior, he is willing to come to your rescue because that is who he is. This morning, we will look at two cases. And I was thinking about three cases, but I said time probably wouldn't permit me. And I want this to be pretty brief for us this morning. But I'll give you two cases. Turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 7, verses 11 through 15. "And it came to pass that when he went into the city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and much people." Verse 12. "Now when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And much people of the city was with her." Verse 14. "And when Jesus, the Lord, saw her, he had compassion on her. Weep not." Verse 14. "And he came and he touched the coffin, and they bared him, stood still. And he said, young man, I say unto thee, arise." Look what verse 15 says. "And he delivered him to his mother." Yesterday we had two funerals. I consider what I do in that regard, I consider it a ministry, because you're at that point where you're able to comfort people at the lowest point of their lives. You don't have to present a lesson or a sermon. You could just be there in their presence. Amen. And let them know. Amen. Your concern. Kenny Loggins said these words, "This is it. When we reached that point, and we are at this point, and people are viewing your body. That's it. But Jesus does something miraculous. And he changed lives. And he can change your life today if you would allow him to. There are some observations that I would like to draw from this particular lesson. The first point that I notice in this particular lesson, passage of scripture, is that no prayers are mentioned at any time for the hopeless situation that Jesus is about to take part of. No prayer. We pray for Brother Reuben. We pray for Sister Carol Pace. We're praying for Robin's brother. But no prayers are mentioned whatsoever here. Here's a second point. Jesus meet death head on. It was a test of who he was and what he could do. A test of what he was and what he could do. In verse 12 of that particular chapter. Here's another point. Jesus feels compassion for human hurts. Don't think for one moment we have a God that doesn't understand what you're going through. The crisis that you're going through, the bereavement that you're going through. He understands, and he is willing to come alongside and give you that comfort because that's what he does. That is who he is. Here's another point that, as an observation, Jesus feels compassion for human hurt. Now listen to this. I know it's there are some exceptions. But normally, children are supposed to bury their parents, not parents burying their children. Like I said, I realize there are some exceptions. 7 verse 13. Here's another observation, is that Jesus conquers death. It's like Jesus is saying, let me give you an intro into what I'm going to do for my own self. What will happen for me in the future? I thought this particular point is so key. Here's this point. Jesus restores broken relationships. We know about the story in the prodigal son. This is a picture of God seeking after and being thrilled, excited, when children, his children, come to him. But Jesus restores broken relationship. Now, in this setting, this is what we know. This was her only son. She was a widow. Kind of remind you of the story of Ruth. But what Jesus does in that particular picture, he brings her son back. Because in those days, the husband, the sons were to take care of the wife and mother. That was their job. That was their responsibility. because that is what Jesus does. What appeared to be hopelessness, Jesus is saying, this is what I do. Here's another story. Jesus healed a man that was crippled for 38 years in John chapter 5, 1 through 17. I will not read all of the verses, but I will make some observations. We're told that he healed a man that had been crippled for 38 long years. Listen to this. The life expectancy in North America for a man, we can expect to live between 75 to 78 years of age. At that time in the Middle East, the age was much shorter. They didn't have all the medical technology that we have. They did not have all of the pharmaceutical products that we can take. But this man is crippled for 38 years. I recall when we were growing up as kids, my mother had an uncle who was blind, and he lived all alone. Every year, my mother would gather the kids up, and what we would do is go over to his house and clean up his house from one room all the way to the end. Every year. I didn't understand it at the time of that big picture, but God knew all about my mother's uncle. This is what I do. I will provide Mrs. Ella Mae Miller to come to your house and assist you in your need. 38 years. That is equivalent to 13,000. 870 days. 832,200 minutes. 49,932,000 seconds. Brother Stan has preached on the subject of miracles that Jesus has performed, so I won't go into that. But I will give you this picture of this man that has been crippled for 38 long years. It's hopeless, hopeless, hopeless. When we look at some of the commentaries, Clark Commentary takes this particular chapter and he gives us this outline. He says that the man who had been disabled or crippled for 38 years was healed on the Sabbath, verses 1 through 9. The Jews cavil, persecuted Christ, and seek to kill him because he had done this cure on the Sabbath, verses 10 through 16. Our Lord vindicates his conduct and shows from the testimony of the Father, the Scriptures, John the Baptist, and his works, that he came from God to be the light and salvation of the world, verses 17 through 29. Jesus said unto the man that was crippled, a simple statement. He says, rise, take up thy bed, and walk. Three things to do in verse 8. Jesus is saying to you, when things in your life appears to be hopeless, this is what I do to bring about deliverance in your life. And some of you here this morning will be able to attest. Let me tell you what he has done for me. I know what he has done for me. And I'm so thankful. And you too should be thankful, excited of what he has done. This morning, we've looked at two cases of lives that appear to be hopeless. The thing that Jesus was able to do, he can change your life today. He can take you out of the darkness that you have been in for such a long period of time. And he can translate you into his marvelous light. He can put your name in the book of life. He can give you a new start, a new change. He can make that transformation in your life today. Because this is what he does, and he is willing to do for you. One can see the mighty power of God today in Christ when you decide that I want Christ into my life. What do I have to do? Hear the word, Romans 10 and verse 7. Believe the word in Hebrews 11 and verse 6. Not only that, repent of one sin, Luke 13, verse 3. Confess the name of Christ, Romans 10 and verse 10. Be baptized for the remission of your sins, Acts 2 and 38. And live faithfully unto death, Revelation 2 and verse 20. He wants you to. He asked of you. And for this body of believers who have seen what God is willing to do, what he has done, they are thankful. But the message is yours this morning. It's for you to take note of. This is what he does. This is what he would do for you. As we sing a hymn of invitation, maybe there's one who will come forth and put Christ on in baptism. Or maybe there's one who would like to be restored because their lives is missing something. That fellowship that they once had with God and with Christ, it's gone because you have distanced yourself from him. Or maybe you here just need prayer. His ears is wide open to hear your petition. Just as he heard the petition of King David, he is willing to hear your petition. If there be one, do come forth as we stand and sing.
When the Savior calls, I will answer. When he calls for me, I will hear. When the Savior calls, I will answer. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere. I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere, listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere, listening for my name. If my heart is right when he calls me, if my heart is right, I will hear. If my heart is right when he calls me, I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere listening for my name. If my robe is white when he calls me, if my robe is white, I will hear. If my robe is white when he calls me, I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere listening for my name. I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere, I'll be somewhere listening for my name.
Thank you, Brother Miller, for that lesson this morning. I have a few announcements. There is a bulletin, or we call it an announcement sheet of both entrances to the building. Hopefully that you picked up one and read over it already. I have a few additional announcements to make. Also, in that brochure that you picked up in the foyers, there's a centerfold. I ask that you read over that, and we will participate. We will participate in that also. So you can read it. It's sponsored by the ladies' class. There will be no small group meeting tonight here at the building. As Brother Miller also said, and good to see Brother Reuben. He was singing hard on that day, I tell you. God bless you and your family. Sister Carol Pace, Brother Jim Appleton, who lives in Canton, Ohio, has been in the hospital ICU for a week and on a ventilator. Carol sends a request that we pray for him and his wife, and also for her. Brother L. Diana, he says, I have a daughter-in-law, Yvette Gonzalez. Pray for her health. Ronnie and Granger Thompson would like to ask the church for prayer for their brother, Ricky Thompson, who is having heart problems and breathing problems. Also, for my wife and I would like to the church to pray for their granddaughter. I guess he called her by her nickname, it's Pickles, who was in Orlando, Florida, at the Olympics Development Camp, hoping and praying that she make it through. We have several visitors, and I only have one visitor's card, and I'm going to read it because this is the only one that I have, but I do know there are others. Was Greg Campbell.
You don't get a card, you know me.
That's why I don't have one, Greg. Okay, it was somebody else. Anyway, okay. We have a Diane and Ted Allen. They live here in Lansing on West Mount Hope Avenue. And they just moved into the area. Just for viewpoint, Diane, and would you and Ted please stand, please, if you care to. Okay, thank you for visiting with us, and hopefully you'll come back and visit with us again. Thank you. Let's pray.
If Lord's willing, my family and I will be traveling to Kentucky next Wednesday for Thanksgiving to be with my grandson. We pray for traveling and grace and mercies, and that we will have a safe return on the trip.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for being God. We're so thankful that you decided to send your son, and he left his home in glory land to come and give his life for us, that we might obtain salvation, and we thank you for that. Father, we just thank you for the first day of the week, that we can come and worship you as brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for those who are ill at this time and do have the desire to come, but they are hindered because of sickness. Be with them, Heavenly Father. Amen. Heavenly Father, be with Yvette Gonzalez. Bless her and keep her in your cares. Heavenly Father, all of those that's listed in our bulletin today, be with them also. Be with all of those who will be traveling, that you will be in the vehicles or on the plane or on the bus or wherever, which way they are traveling. Keep them safe. Amen. Be with Ronnie Thompson's brother, Granger, Heavenly Father, who's having heart problems and breathing problems. Put your arms around him, Heavenly Father, and just give him the strength to keep going. Heavenly Father, we pray for also for his their granddaughter, who was in Orlando at an Olympic development camp. We pray that, Heavenly Father, that she will make it through. Father, we just thank you for all of the good things in this life that come from you. And help us not forget that it's nothing that we've done on our own.
Amen.
But it was through your love and your grace. Be with our visitors, Heavenly Father. We pray for them. And we, if they live here in town, we certainly hope that they'll come back again.
Amen.
Just be with this congregation. Bless it and keep it, Heavenly Father, in your word. Forgive us our sins when we do wrong. Once again, we thank you for your blessings. In your Son's name we pray. And the church says,
Amen.
Amen.